Welcome to Gateway Church. We're glad that you are here today. My name is Matt, and I invite you to be seated at this time. We are starting a new series here at Gateway Church called Welcome Home. We know that a lot of you have been on summer vacations. All the little kids that are over there are so excited to go back to school. There's some new university students, I'm sure, here. And we are glad that you came here. I know that parents, at least for me, we were looking through our pantries wondering, oh dear, do I have enough stuff for my kids' lunches? All that type of thing. We know what's going on. No matter where you came from, we want to let you know, welcome home.
Chuck, think Daddy's home.
Don't worry, we won't do that to you today. Anyways, if you are new here, we are very excited for you to be here. After the service, please take an opportunity to find the guest services counter in the atrium. We have a little gift that we would like to give you just for saying thank you for coming today. Here at Gateway, there's a lot of volunteers that participate in many different ways, from sound, lighting, all the way to our video stuff, music team, kids church. I can't name them all, but we'd like to thank them right now for all that they do. And we would also like to push you guys, if you don't currently serve here, take the opportunity following the service to find somebody in the atrium that'll have a Next Step Coach tag on their chest, or one of the pastors, and we would love to get you involved and to see you guys volunteer helping further the kingdom. At this time, I would like you guys to take some time to meet some new people, and we'll be right back.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road, and although this wave is stringing us along, know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. The trouble, it might drag you down. You get lost, you can always be found. Just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home.
Hiding place, our hope is safe within your name. This we know, this we know. never to forsake. What you began, you will sustain. This sweet hope, this sweet hope. I will call upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to save. Rise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. Fullness of your word, this sweet hope, this sweet hope, and every enemy will flee as we declare your victory. Oh,
Singing with us. You may be seated.
Legacy is about life and living. It's about learning from the past, living in the present, and building for the future. It helps us decide the kind of life we want to live and the kind of world we want to live in.
For our children, it means learning from the past. Children have to have a feeling of security, and that comes from knowing that there's adults who care about them and want to invest in their future.
For adults, legacy means hoping for the future. It means developing and passing on a timeless part of yourself. We feel valued and useful no matter how old we get.
We understand that the world we leave behind is the world our children and our children's children will one day inherit.
The world is connected by stories, traditions, memories, hopes, and dreams. We're connected by the legacies passed down from those who came before us, and the legacies we pass down to those who came after us.
We're all part of a larger community. A community that must remember its history to build its future.
I can hardly believe that it's been 18 years since we've been here.
I mean,
so much has changed. Remember when we first came? We had all our dreams and our hopes and, you know.
A few fears mixed in with that.
A few fears. We wondered, you know, could we do it? You know, did God want us to actually build and relocate? Would all these things happen, or was it just kind of a nice idea? It's been quite a ride. And when I think about the future, I think about the families to come, and I think of the more children come, and we consider the Raise the Roof in this campaign now as we're trying to raise the dollars to continue on, especially specialized ministries for children and for young people and young adults. This second floor is gonna make a significant impact in the future.
It's why we do what we do. It's about the future.
Yeah.
It's about our legacy. Everything we do today is for what's yet to come. And really, that's why this next phase is so important.
You know, going back to when we first made the decision to build here at Gateway, we knew that it was gonna cost so much money. And there was the question of, do you do what God's asking you to do, or do you? And what if you can't afford to do? I learned a long time ago, there's sometimes you think there's things that you can't afford to do, and there's some things you can't afford not to do. That's what it was for us when we moved here and we built this. We couldn't afford not to do it because God had some big plans. And I think that about the second floor. We believe this is something that God has called us to. We want you to believe in that too. God has a plan. He's looking for us to get behind it. For both young and old, the power of legacy allows us to live fully in the present. You understand that you're part of a larger community, a community that must remember its history in order to build its future.
I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward to receive our giving this morning. This is where we take a portion of what God has blessed us with and give it back to Him to further His kingdom. We'd also like to point out that we're getting there, 68% of the way to raising the funds for our Raise Our Roof campaign. Please keep that in your mind. Please keep giving towards it, and we will reach our goal. If you are new here at Gateway, do not feel compelled in any way to give. We appreciate that you have chosen to join us today. There are several things happening around this church in the upcoming weeks. The first one that I would like to point out is that we have our annual Labor Day barbecue and corn roast at the Hibma Farm today. It is at 5 p.m. And we would like to see all of you there. If you are new to Gateway, this is an excellent opportunity for you to connect with some people in the Gateway family. You really need to go. The second thing I would like to point out is last week, many of you were here, and you would have heard Pastor Dave's heart regarding the courses that happen here at Gateway Church. There are many courses that are here. If you missed his heart, we would love for you to go online and watch that video. But there are many courses that happen here at Gateway Church. After the service in the atrium, please find a Next Step coach, and they will point you in the direction of which course would best suit you for this time, this season of your life. You can also register for courses on our Gateway app. It's a lot more convenient if that's the way you choose to do it. The last thing I would like to point out is that we are so thrilled and so excited for our Pursuit Conference 2016. Anybody? I've got two people. All right, come on. There we go. You will hear more about what's happening in the coming weeks, but we do want you to take out your calendars right now and write in there October 14th till October 16th. Nobody else is allowed to have your time. Just so you know, okay? We want to see you there. We are thrilled and excited for this, and we are anticipating a great time.
Welcome home, everybody. Turn to someone and say, welcome home. Welcome home. It's this time of year again as the kids are back to school and summer holidays are over, and we transition into what for the church is often the new year for us. Is it a new season for us? And as we begin that, we always like to start this new season off looking at the mission, the vision, the values, and who we are as a church, and ask ourselves and remind ourselves, why this church? Why do I go to this church? Why should I belong? Do I belong? And what's the measure of belonging? And is just because I come, does that mean that I belong? Or is there more than just coming on a Sunday morning? I was, as we were talking about this, I had this real sense that I'm glad that I'm a part of this church. I love this church, and it's in a little bit like family. I want you to have that sense that you love it as much as we love being here. We give our lives to Christ, we surrender to Him, and then what starts out as a personal decision, I give my life to Christ, it then becomes a corporate thing as we experience life together. And I was thinking back when Gateway was previously located at 556 Wonderland Road, and it was formerly called Glad Tidings Assembly. When I was a young boy as a Christian, before there was overflows, there was we had these youth conventions or youth rallies, we called them. And when I was 12 or 13 years old, I would go with my youth group of eight of us, in Meaford, Ontario, and our youth pastor, and we would drive for almost 3 hours to London, and we would go to this Glad Tidings church. It was the biggest church in the whole world. I'd never seen anything like it. And there was like 300 young people. I didn't know there was 300 Christian young people anywhere on earth. And I and everybody was having a good time, and there were some really, really good-looking girls, and I was like, it was just inspiring to be a Christian all over again. And I got saved all over again. That I never forget those days. But the point was is that being up from a small town in a small church and thinking it was just me, and I'm trying to live my faith out in high school and as a kid, and I don't know if I can do this. And then I come to something like that event, and I was reminded that back then and taught that I was part of something that was far bigger, far larger. Welcome home. I want to remind you that you are part, as a Christian, you are part of something that is far bigger. It's called the family of God. And we love being a part of this family. This is my church. And just a few questions that I have for you to mull over as we're kind of, Blair and I are just kind of walking through this today, is why do you go to this church? Why this church? Why Gateway? And I think it's important to love your church, but I think it's also important to reevaluate and to reflect on why. Why do I love this church? What is it that keeps me coming here? Please tell me it's the incredible preaching. Actually, I don't want you to tell me that, because that's not enough to keep you. And so we're wanting to talk today a little bit about why we belong to this church. And I think it starts and ends with the word family. From the very beginning, God wanted a family. And he put Adam and Eve in the garden. His plan of salvation through his son, Jesus Christ, that is the entire biblical narrative of the children of Israel, all of the bottom line of all of this is that God wanted a family. He put you on here so that you could experience a family relationship with him, and that together we can experience that one another. And that's why we do church.
It's about sharing, the sharing God's glory. That sounds like it should be singing.
You sound like God.
You should listen then. It's very good. Oh, it's about sharing his glory. He created all of this for us to enjoy with him. God didn't set it up and look, hey, aren't I awesome? But he put Adam and Eve in it, and then you can imagine God laughing together with Adam and Eve. You can imagine God like play wrestling with Jacob, if you're familiar with the story, all night until poor dad hurt son's hip and wrecked it, kind of thing. But there's the sense of like, let's do this together. Let's share all of life together. And he said, before time even began, this is what I have. I have individual specific purposes and plans for each of your life. But to share in this relationship with other people, to get there together, you're going to need other people. You're going to need a family. You're going to need a church to develop you into being the person that you're really, really supposed to be. You can imagine that Jesus was playing tag with kids and then had the kids sit on his lap and tell a story. It's all about family. It's all about sharing. It's all about pouring into one another's lives. When I think about the calling and the purpose on my life, it's exactly how it's developed. I grew up in a Christian home and going to the midweek program called Crusaders. Anybody? Crusaders, and we got the badges and the sash and all these things together, and got involved in the youth group a little bit, and then my parents took me to this like Bible study course because they thought I was old enough for it when I was about 12, which is not a bad idea. I would love parents to bring kids to their own kids to Alpha and Starting Point and Cleansing Stream, and to do this all before you finish high school, that would be great. So my parents took me to a course, and I remember rededicating my life to him because I didn't just want to hang on to the faith of a 5-year-old or a 6-year-old where maybe I knew what I was doing, maybe I didn't, but I rededicated my life, and then a year later felt God's call upon my life. And what was fun about hearing the call of God on my life at a camp with a youth group and a youth pastor and all of those kind of family situations together, it was the confirmation of it throughout high school that came from my old Sunday school teacher. And he had since moved off and came back, and then he was talking to me about it. I'm like, oh, who told you? It's not like there was email and Facebook back in, you know, 93 or something. But he's like, oh, when I was leading your class, we were praying for every kid in the class. It wasn't something I had to do. It was a ministry I loved to do and longed to do. And I thought of you and we prayed over your life and God told me that you were going to be a pastor. God told me this was be. And I'm so excited to see that kind of develop in your life. And I'm so glad to be a part of your life for that time. It was a family, a church family that put me with a microphone in my hand years and years later. And all the things that I learned that I couldn't be who God wanted me to be without church family. And this is what we wanted to be created. This is what we want you to talk about.
So it's simply put, but it's not simply done. And the reality is this, is that for some of you, you measure church. Okay, I come to church. If coming to church is more than, if it's only 75-minute service for you, I come for, you know, 20-minute sermon, a 30-minute sermon, and four songs, and, you know, there's some, you know, coffee at the back, and there's some stuff to sign up for that they're always bugging you.
A game at the beginning, yeah, so you can come a little bit.
Dumb game, or whatever it is
whatever
at the thing.
It is at the beginning.
There's a moment there where I got to shake hands with a few creepy people that I don't really know or like or care. And I've done my church. Like, that's not family. You haven't even begun to experience what we're trying to create. You have not even tasted where we're going and what we are and who what we're a part of. And so spiritual family can be a very difficult thing for a variety of reasons. One, for some of us, we equate that with our own families, and if our own families was dysfunctional, if our own families was broken, then, and we interpret the church that and say, well, if the church family is supposed to be like family, like my family, then I don't want to be a part of a church because of my past experiences. So I think that's a bit of a challenge. The other thing that I think we're challenged by in terms of our understanding of spiritual family is that we're not really good at relationships anymore. I mean, you got to understand that we're getting worse at relationships. I mean, we measure our friendships by how many likes we get on an Instagram picture of something you ate at a restaurant that nobody cares. And then we measure by the likes. We measure by the number of friends we have. But the reality is they're not your friends. You don't speak to them. They don't speak to you. And it's really weirdest when there's a problem. Like, when someone passes away and there's like 75 condolences, RIP, so sad for your loss. And I'm not saying that it's not a gesture, but that's not relationship. Relationship is going to the house and when they open the door, saying nothing, putting your arms around them and holding them while they cry. That's relationship. And my point is that if you come on Sunday and you don't get to what we're talking about, it's no different than when there's a loss and you getting a condolences on your Facebook page. You're coming to church, but you're not experiencing family. You're not getting it. You've got to get past that. You've got to get into the hearts and the lives of people. And we're getting worse at this. We're not getting better at this. The church is the only place where you can truly experience deepening friendships. They're not your friends at the gym just because you give them a high five once in a while. You've got to get past that if you're going to experience what God created when He created the church.
We used to call it fellowship.
Fellowship.
Fellowship and that kind of thing. On Sunday, after Sunday night service every month, I swear, in my head it goes back to that. We'd have this thing called fellowship in the fellowship hall. Anybody remember what that was? That kind of idea? It was really great as a kid growing up because it was a buffet of all-you-can-eat competition of desserts.
I love fellowship.
All of the moms would be like, I've got the best dessert. I've got the best. I'm like, great, have a competition.
Please
let me decide. Please compete for the best square. Oh, I like this option. I would try them
fellowship.
All. And we go, isn't this
I
great?
I had a lot of fellowship.
A lot of fellowship growing up. Yeah, you did. Yeah. And then
you didn't have to agree that fast.
Wow. And then we go to it and go, well, I'm in fellowship because I went and had some squares, you know, or this is the best one. Why does the church have late night, Saturday night hockey, pickup hockey? Well, because the men need some fellowship. And you're like, there's no fellowship on the ice rink. It might begin there. This is where we got to know each other. What's your name? No, you're the guy with the red helmet. Like, who wears a red helmet? It's target time. That's a target practice. Hit that guy. Here, what's your name again? Whatever. Sub. And then... But we called it fellowship, well, that was the idea, but if it just stuck there, it didn't do anything. It didn't give a deeper sense and meaning. Like if you see somebody coming in here on a Sunday morning and they're hugging somebody, they're praying for somebody, they're crying over someone, they're laughing so much they feel like they're falling over, it's because something else has happened that you missed out on. There was somewhere else that they were where the conversation didn't just went to the Blue Jays and some weather. You know, and I can always talk about the Blue Jays. Like, that would be easy. Or complain about my kids. No problem at all. But if it doesn't go further than that, then we're stuck. And then when something bad happens, like you said, then I blame the church, and then what?
Well, yeah, because fellowship doesn't just happen. You choose. You make it happen. You decide that you're going to get involved into a person's life. You decide that you're going to let someone into your life. One of the things that I will often say here, and it's part of the values, and that's really what we're talking about here today, the values. What is it that drives us here? And that is that everybody needs to have a brother, a father, and a son. Every woman needs to have a sister, a mother, and a daughter. You have to have somebody that you are in relationship with, a sister or brother, that will bring you along, that you're working together to become more than you can be on your own. But you also have to have a child. You have to have someone that you are inspiring, that you are saying, follow me as I follow Christ. You all have to have someone in your life that is looking at you and saying, when I grow up, I want to be like you someday. And we all have to have fathers and mothers, people that we look at them and go, that's the goal. That's what I want to become. I see Jesus in you, and I want to become like that someday. So the question is, who's your brother? Your sister? Who's your mother? Who's your daddy? Who's your son or your daughter?
I can remember a couple years ago, we did this with Pursuit, and you'd miss it if you didn't come because we're so busy and it makes sense and you've got good excuses, we get it. But for those that were there, remember, because it was such a powerful moment. First, we had all those 60 and up kind of come up to the front, and the speaker prayed over them and they prayed for each other. But then the next generation joined them across the front. And so the 60-year-olds played for the 50-year-olds, and then the 50s to the 40s and 40s to 30s all the way down. So everybody was here and you could see it and you could feel it. It was like, I need you to invest into my life. And if I want to enjoy this life that God has given me, I need to pour my life into somebody else. And it was so easy to see and so important to say, like, I'm a part of it. I'm proud about it. I'm excited about it that God is doing something in the life of this multi-generational church.
And we all have a role to play in that. Like, I remember as a child, and I can close my eyes and I can go back there. It was in a Sunday school classroom. Her name was Mrs. Scarrow, and I can still see her in the purple dress. And it was her who led me to Christ. And it was she helped me, and we prayed together that I invited Jesus into my heart. And then I went home and I told my mom and dad, and I'm here today because of Mrs. Scarrow. Who are you Mrs. Scarrow to? Like for parents and for those of you who have younger children, you don't raise a child on your own. You need a village. You need a community to do that. I'm so grateful that I get to be a pastor, but I'm also grateful that this church pastored my kids. Ashley and Gabby, they're now adults. They've moved on, and they both love Jesus, and they're both doing great things for God, but they're doing it because of people like you that spoke into their lives. So all I'm just pressing on you today is whose are you speaking into now? Like, for those of you who just come, get past the 75-minute Sunday squat and think you've done church. You have an opportunity. If you say, well, I don't really need fellowship. I've got enough friends and I can manage it all by myself. Well, you know what? Then somebody needs you. Who can you speak into? Who are you actively speaking into right now on a regular basis where you're pouring into them, that they're looking at you saying, I want to be like you someday? Those of you who are older, you're not retired, so stop it. Stop it! You should be involved in the kids programs. You should be involved on Wednesday in the kids programs, and you should be involved with the young people. And you say, "Well, I don't do kids anymore. I raised mine." That's the whole point. You failed the first round, so why don't you try a second time? See if you do it better. You have an opportunity to speak into their lives and to inspire them. And my girls will often talk about some of the adults in this room that made a difference in their lives, and they're still talking to them. They're still impacting their lives. You have an opportunity. You have a responsibility to do that, to share into the hearts and the lives of one another. And so I want to appeal to you. I want to beg you today that you choose to belong. You choose to belong, and a Christian without a church family is an orphan, and God never, ever designed us to be orphans. He designed us to be part of the family of God. Is that all right? Is that all right?
And the choice doesn't come like before Sunday morning. It comes before Sunday morning. You don't wait till Sunday morning to decide. It's like you wake up on a Sunday morning and go, "Hey, I feel like going to church today." Oh, I'll let my feelings tell me where my choices go. Well, that won't lead us very far. It's a choice to come to church on a Sunday way before you get there, and that coming here only less than twice a month, less than half the time, you're not going to find family. You're not going to find fellowship. We often talk about the stats. Church attendance is dropping all the time. They talk about just under twice a month is about the average. And we're losing our family when we do that. It's not enough. You come here half the time, there's a slim chance that family's going to happen. It's when it's more than that, and it comes to be a choice. I'm coming to church no matter who's singing. I'm coming to church no matter what the topic is. I don't really think the series is for me. That's fine. It's more about the culture of what's going on in between the seats, before you come, before you, after coming. Oh, Pastor Tim is speaking today. I'm coming to church. Let's do it. Let's get involved with whatever's kind of going on, because I'm choosing to be a part. I'm choosing to find my place. I'm choosing to invest into somebody else's life.
And if you don't do this, then what happens is we have this presumption or this expectation of relationship that's actually false. So you think because you've got a full Facebook list, and because you come to church on Sunday and there's a few people that you can smile and say hi to and chit-chat during the shake-a-paw time, that you think that somehow you're in fellowship or you're in relationship. And then when your world goes crazy, and then when it gets messy, and all you get is a few comments on Facebook or you come in here, you can come into a church this size and feel like you're the loneliest person in the world. And all you want to do is cry and sit in a corner and suck your thumb because nobody is reaching out to you. Because you didn't take the time to choose to get involved and be a part of someone's life. And you didn't risk the opportunity to be vulnerable enough to let somebody in. And then when there's somebody who's grumpy or somebody, you know, says something that you don't like, oh, the church is this, the church is this. No. You can't just presume that you're just this wonderful person and that the other 500 people are just mean, rotten people. No. You've got to get involved in relationship before there's a problem. And if you don't get there, if you're not on that journey with other people and being vulnerable and being involved in their lives on a regular basis, then when the rain comes, when the storm comes, you'll be all on your own, and God never intended for that to happen. And so you choose to belong, but you also choose to invite people into your life. And the best way to invite them into your life is to invite them into your home. To invite them into your home. And that's why we encourage you. You've got to do life together in ministry and in culture. You do that in the living room. You do that by inviting people into your home and having them over and praying together and getting past the Blue Jays and just like... Were you
golf? Golf.
Shush. But you get into that opportunity where you say, "How are things?" And you don't just do "How are things" here, but you've got to do it on a regular basis, to in such a way that you actually can build an encouragement to one another, and you risk that those opportunities and those experiences by exposing yourself and by allowing yourself the opportunity to get into a deeper relationship. So belonging to a home group, belonging to something that's greater than Sunday morning, as we said, you know, we're not trying. People will say, "Well, I come to church because I'm trying to get fed." Well, then this is probably not the church for you, because we're not trying to feed you. There's other churches where their goal is, we want to feed you on Sunday. We're going to take a steak dinner, we're going to ram it down your throat, and then you got your God on for the week, and you don't need anything else until the following Sunday. That's not us. We're not trying to feed you on a Sunday morning. When someone tells me they're not being fed, I go, "I don't understand that, because I wasn't trying to feed you. I'm trying to teach you how to eat." We're trying to teach you how to make your own meal. We're trying to show you the fridge and the opportunity for you to make an own meal so that you can be strong, stand on 2 feet, be confident in your faith enough that you can feed yourself through God's word, through worship, and you can actually be a contributing member to the family of God. Our role is to equip you to do the work of God's kingdom. And that's what we're trying to do here.
You finally make it all the way to the Hibmas, and then you're going to have to ask the right questions and spend some time listening. I think Angela on Thursday morning, for those ladies that are part of community, and I always tease the name with Angela with WM and Women's Aglow, that kind of thing. And maybe you just hear announcements, and you're like, well, they got a lot of programs. They're really trying to busy my life up. And you're like, no, it's the women's community isn't another program. I'll ask her after every Thursday how it went, and she'll always tell a story, but someone risked the chance to share, and then they're all crying, and then there was a prayer huddle, and then there's cards and meals and gifts involved, and the pastors are all looking through the window like, what's going on? Finally, real church, real family, real sense of caring and community where life is birthed, and that it's an awesome thing. It's an amazing thing, and I think guys can take a tip from that to say that we need each other. We need to risk taking the chance to share. We mentioned that in our Ten Commandments series when it comes to lying and telling the full truth. That when somebody says, hey, how's life going? And you're like, well, if you got the time, I want to tell you the whole truth. It's a bit of a mess right now and I need help. Would you listen? Maybe not provide help, but like, would you listen? Because I feel alone in this. And that would be so powerful, whether it's on a Sunday or at a program or on the way to hockey. Like we teach you how to, we give you the event. Now it's time for you to eat at it. Don't just like, okay, I showed up. Aren't I in fellowship? I'll have another square and not talk about what needs to be talked about. How's about another square?
Yeah. So we want you to belong. We want you to be a part of the family. We want you to partner with one another so that you can speak fellowship into the life of each other. But we also want you to understand that we are together. And so there's a question of partnership that we have if we're going to make this the wonderful place that it is. Because one of the greatest ways that you'll experience fellowship is when you're serving together, when you're working together, when you're doing ministry together, and when you're doing sharing the responsibilities. I know that when my kids were growing up, there was this idea of chores. And I don't know about your kids, but if you said, hey, do you want to do your chores? No. I mean, my kids never
Why said, do I have to do it?
Why do I have to
Why
do, the
do I have to do it? I wish that would go away with adults though.
Yeah.
did you real.
Are you comfortable right now? Do you enjoy the chairs here? Do you know that there's a group of people that got here at 7 o'clock this morning? And don't tell me, oh, they're morning people. No, I see their face.
They must be.
Yeah, no, they're not morning people. I can tell their faces.
And you said good morning and they grunted.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh.
They don't speak English until their third coffee.
Yeah.
They understand that they have a responsibility. They have a responsibility. And people would say, well, you know, I it's not my thing. Well, what is your thing? What is your thing? I mean, nobody wants to just find themselves. I'm sure Romeo doesn't want to do any more cooking. I'm sure that there's other people that just go.
One more trip to Costco for the Greg Anises, you know, yeah. Pushing two carts.
I love stacking chairs. No, we
nobody
understand
does
all
that.
Of that.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. You don't get to ministry until you first start with responsibility. Responsibility comes first. People say, well, I'm looking for a ministry. Here's a clue. You're never going to find it. You don't find a ministry until you accept responsibility. Responsibility comes first. And you say, you know what? I will be responsible. I will get involved. I will find an opportunity. Everyone who comes here. Now, we have almost 250 volunteers, but we have 1,500 people that make Gateway their home. So I'd like to know what the other 1,000 of you are doing. Like, we're not asking you to be a slave. We're saying find an area of responsibility. And if you will find an area of responsibility, I believe that one day then God will hand you a ministry. He will hand you a ministry.
And you could see it on the faces of those people that are serving when it's their ministry. Like, you could see when Pete Jaffelis plays guitar that you're like, is this a responsibility? It's all over him. And if you didn't let him do that, he would be a mess. He would be absolutely, he couldn't live without it. And you could see that away when Andy says hi to you in the morning for the last 40, 50 years, like that it's his ministry, and it's like, don't take this away from me. Being a greeter is the greatest thing on earth. And you're like, that sounds crazy.
Like, you know, he's over 80 years old. I mean, he's been doing this so long, now we have to have a chair for him to sit in because he can't even stand that
long anymore.
Don't
take it from me. Don't take it from me.
So who's the next Andy? Who's going to be the next Andy? One day he's going to get his eternal reward and he'll be gone from here. A sad day that will be for all of us. But who's the next Andy? What area of ministry and responsibility are you taking up? Because there is all kinds of opportunities that if you're faithful to the responsibility, then God will give you the ministry. Do you know that we were at Western until after 2 o'clock in the morning on Friday night? It was such an incredible, I mean, I was talking to you about this last week. It went so well, Western has come back and said, we want you at every single event that Western does. Do you know how many volunteers we're going to need? And you know what? It's great handing out the water. Not so great carrying 5 gallon jugs of water, dozens of them, because they went through 75 or 80 gallons of water, 1,500 cups of water. It was crazy. So there's responsibility. Again, what's your responsibility? And is it leading to a ministry? We just want you to try and get involved. And out of that, you will find the richest of rewards. You will find your Christian walk develops like you can't believe. And you will find that all of a sudden, this will become home. This will become family.
We often talk about church or here is we want it to be life in the house. And when you're part of a ministry, when you find your thing and it becomes so thrilling to you, it can't help but be an exciting place to be, a passionate place to be, something you look forward to that you'll push away time and just be invested in. And we believe that comes when the Spirit of God with other people do stuff together, that there's this level of loving each other's family. It turns into kinship, where the Spirit of God comes inside it and between a few people, and it's explosive. Like the best thing, the greatest thing you'll ever do is to help someone go from not believing into believing. So if you join a group like an Alpha Table, that kind of thing, and you invite a few other people, and he was like, will you help me with this person? We're going to all come to this table and we're going to talk about it. And then when they get baptized, like you couldn't high five hard enough. You couldn't happy dance enough. It's just like there's so much excitement in that. And then you take them from Alpha into Foundations in Faith, and you take that same person, that same group, all the way through a cleansing stream, walking in the Spirit, and you're like, this is so exciting. This is so life-giving. And it starts with the worship team going to like Arcade, and you're like bringing people along and talking about your faith, and then finding that the Spirit of God is speaking through you. It'll make you weep. It'll make you cry. Happiness and sadness, and you're a bit of a mess. You don't even know what you are. But you wouldn't want to ever go back. And you'll tell somebody, why are you a believer? Why are you a believer? Because God spoke, God used, God said, God did. Ongoing in my life and the life in the church that you're like, I couldn't live without. I'm a different person because of all of it.
And if we do this right, as Blair said, we get to kinship. Kinship is a word that we don't use a lot nowadays, but there are a few applications where we do use it. And the biggest one is when you go to the hospital and you're about to have a surgery, and the nurse says, when she's filling out your church, they say, who's your next of kin? In other words, who do you want us to call if this doesn't go well? If you die, who do you want to know? Now make the spiritual application. Who's your next of kin? Who's your next of kin? See, we don't want to step up because we lie to ourselves and say we're too busy, or we say, well, you know what? My life's not in a good place. My life is all messed up. So I really couldn't help anybody else up right now. You know what? Your life's always going to be messed up. There's always going to be reason, always going to be excuse. There's always going to be a problem. There's always going to be something that will keep you from discovering who's your next of kin. Family. God's idea, and we together are home. And I'm so grateful that this is our church. This is my church. And I hope you can say that with the same pride and that same joy. This is my church. We know that we're coming into the September season, and people that have been kind of coming back and forth throughout the summer months, and you're making a choice. I pray that you will find a church that you can say, this is my church. I'm home. I'm home. My kids are home. My marriage is home. I'm going to find my wife or husband here. Boy, I don't know. This is where I'm going to make my life better. So welcome home, Gateway. Welcome home. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your goodness and your faithfulness. And Lord, we are so grateful for the new people that are here today. Lord, for our college students and university students, Lord, that are the ones that are leaving, I pray they find a church family wherever they find themselves. For those who are coming, may this be a wonderful experience for them for 2 years or 4 years or six or however long we have them. Lord, for those that are, for moms and dads that are getting ready for school on Tuesday and just kind of, everything just kind of feels overwhelming, Lord, I pray that every family will thrive as our church family thrives, and that together we'll do life better than we could ever do it on our own. So, Father, thank you that we can call this home, that we can call this family. And I pray, Lord, that you look down on all of this and you say, that's my family. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you today.
Thank you so much, pastors. Aren't we fortunate to have such a wonderful pastors leading us? We would like to take the opportunity right now for you guys to answer and discuss a few questions among yourselves. So find somebody that you don't know or don't know very well and ask these questions. Why am I at Gateway? Some of you haven't asked this question and you need to ask this question. Why am I at Gateway? Why do I go here? And then be a little vulnerable. Encourage somebody. Take some time to tell them why you appreciate them, what God has done with them, and how they've blessed your life. So let's take some time right now to discuss. When my way is dark, your light breaks through. Thank you so much for coming out today. Please continue the conversation, and we hope that you have an amazing week, and we can't wait to see you next week. Thank you.